So in this moment, we must be crystal clear. We stand with Israel.
In a show of force, the Pentagon is moving the USS Gerald Ford, that is the Navy's newest and most advanced aircraft carrier, closer to Israel.
We call on all countries, particularly those with the greatest capacity to give, to join us in meeting the UN's appeal for the humanitarian situation in Gaza.
This is a tough issue. There have been four wars there in the last 15 years, and ain't going to be solved tomorrow. But while we do our best to support Israel and destroy Hamas, please let us not turn our back on the suffering people in Gaza.
Israel and Hamas are again at war, and ordinary people in Israel, the West Bank, and Gaza are mourning the loss of their friends and family. According to Israeli officials, 1,200 Israelis were killed when Hamas attacked on October 7th. Israel has since mounted an offensive to eliminate Hamas that has killed more than 12,000 people in Gaza, with tens of thousands more injured, according to estimates by Palestinian public health officials and international observers. At the same time, more than 200 Israeli hostages are still missing, and there is no clear end to the war in sight. Neither is there a long-term solution to the overall Israeli-Palestinian conflict, which has been unfolding since Israel's creation 75 years ago, and which touches on questions that are thousands of years old. People around the world are debating the conflict, sometimes bitterly. But one thing is for certain. As is the case in Ukraine, even without troops on the ground, the U.S. is part of this war. We wanted to understand exactly why and how. What is the U.S. currently doing in the region? How much influence do we really have? And how did Israel become such an important priority for the U.S. in the first place? I sat down with friend of the pod, Stephen Cook, senior fellow for the Middle East and Africa here at CFR. His work largely focuses on Middle East politics and U.S. policy in the Middle East. Our conversation is largely unedited. I'm Gabrielle Sierra, and this is Why It Matters. Today, understanding the U.S. role in the Israel-Hamas war with Stephen Cook. Hi, Stephen. Welcome back to Why It Matters.
Hey, it's great to be back.
All right, so let's start with the current moment. Is the United States involved in the Israel-Hamas war right now?
The fact is that the United States is engaged in this conflict in a variety of ways. And first and foremost, after Hamas attacked Israel on October 7th, and President Biden expressed his heartfelt solidarity with the Israeli people, he ordered U.S. military forces into the region. Specifically, he ordered the USS Gerald R. Ford carrier battle group into the Eastern Mediterranean. This is the largest aircraft carrier in the world with all of the ships and planes that go with it. He also ordered an aircraft carrier battle group into the Persian Gulf and deployed additional Air Force assets and put about 2,000 U.S. Marines on standby. Now, none of these military movements were specifically for U.S. forces to fight alongside the Israelis. They were clearly intended to send a message to Israel's other adversaries in the region that any steps taken to widen the conflict beyond Israel and the Gaza Strip would be met with a resounding American response. And that message was specifically directed at Hezbollah, Lebanese organization that's been around since the early 1980s, which is, you know, part of what's called the Axis of Resistance, of which Hamas is part of, and to the Iranians, which is sort of the patron of the Axis of Resistance. And there was clearly an effort to send the message that widening the conflict is not in either Hezbollah or Iran's effort.
Okay, so what is the Axis of Resistance?
Yeah, I threw that out there. So Iran's overall goal is to drive the United States out of the Middle East. And one of the ways in which they try to do this is through proxy groups like Lebanon's Hezbollah, Palestinian Islamic Jihad, the Houthis in Yemen, and of course, Hamas. Now, all of these groups are kind of under the umbrella of the axis of resistance, but they have, you know, varying degrees of autonomy. And so through these proxies, Iran has the ability to sow chaos in and around the borders of America's partners in the region. And Hamas has specific nationalist goals and other goals that align with Iran's goals as well, which is, quite frankly, the destruction of Israel.
So just to circle back to where we are, it makes sense that we want to make sure this war doesn't spread to all these other places. But just so I fully understand, our aircraft carriers and the rest, they're not boots on the ground. They're not doing any shooting at all. They're just sort of floating there intimidatingly, telling everyone to sort of stay chill.
Right. I mean, if you've ever been up near a modern American warship, they are...
It is not chill.
It is definitely, definitely an intimidating sight. I mean, American warships have shot down missiles that the Houthis in Yemen have fired in Israel's direction. And that's the point. I think in addition to deterrence, the idea is to provide assistance should the Israelis need it in terms of missile defense. So, you know, Israel has very sophisticated layers of missile defense. The Iron Dome system, which people have heard about, was an Israeli project that the United States joined in 2012. But if the war were to widen and to include Hezbollah, they have reportedly in excess of 100,000, some estimate as much as 150,000 rockets that can hit Israel. Under those circumstances, Israel's defense systems would be at best taxed and at worst, not likely to be able to keep up with the rate of fire from Lebanon. And so the United States, those ships in the region would be a backstop for Israel's own defenses. And I suspect, because there are reports that President Biden took the unusual step of communicating directly with the Iranian leadership, that he warned them in the event that the war is widened, the United States will respond in a resounding kind of way, which raises the stakes in this conflict for Americans. We also sent senior military officers to Israel to talk to them about American experiences in Iraq in trying to root out the Islamic State in both Iraq and Syria and the challenges that that represents, because the Gaza Strip, 25 miles long, 6 miles wide, is a very, very built up area, and that Hamas is in these built up areas and that wanted to give the Israelis whatever wisdom they would take from the U.S. military from engaging in urban conflict. And then, of course, the United States is engaged in a broad-based diplomatic effort to manage the conflict. The president went to Israel. Secretary of State Antony Blinken has been to Israel and surrounding countries a number of times. The Secretary of Defense has been in Israel and other countries in the region. And all of this is to seek ways to manage this conflict. And then in the case of Secretary Blinken, is to think about what happens after the conflict.
That being said, what exactly do we want? Does the U.S. want a ceasefire? And if we asked for one, would it happen?
The administration's official position is that we do not want a ceasefire, that a ceasefire would provide an opportunity for Hamas to regroup and rearm, and that a ceasefire would turn into some sort of return to the status quo that would provide Hamas an opportunity to do what it did on October 7th once again. And, you know, from the distance of 6,000 miles, you can understand the strategic advantage of not having a ceasefire, right? That if your goal is to destroy Hamas, you have to keep the pressure on. And the Israelis are also making the case that the military onslaught is giving them leverage in negotiations over the return of hostages, and that a ceasefire would dissipate and that there would be really no chance of getting people back. But of course, 11,000 people have been killed. There's some number that are Hamas terrorists, but at the same time, there are huge numbers of children who have been killed. And of course, what the numbers that we know now are an undercount because, you know, northern Gaza is in rubble. And undoubtedly, there are people buried under these buildings that the Israelis have taken down through their military force. So it's extremely, extremely difficult to watch. And of course, you know, this is a war that is on television. It's online. It's also subject to massive amounts of mis and disinformation.
Okay, so the United States isn't currently pursuing a ceasefire. So what, if anything, has the U.S. done in support of Palestinian civilians during this war?
Well, you know, the United States has been calling for humanitarian corridors for pauses in the fighting, but its protests and its desires have essentially fallen on deaf ears on Israel. Maybe fallen on deaf ears is not fair. I mean, the Israelis did open up. There are pauses during the day to allow Palestinians to move to the south, which is allegedly safer. I think the problem that the United States has in providing the humanitarian assistance that it wants or bringing the Israelis to heel so that humanitarian assistance can come in is two things. One, the Israelis define this conflict in existential terms. Prime Minister Netanyahu himself said it in one of his media interviews, like, we have no choice, we have no other place to go. And there's a sense that unless they destroy Hamas, there's a part of sovereign Israel that will be uninhabitable. So that's number one. I think the second problem is that there has been a problem in the Gaza Strip in which Hamas has diverted humanitarian assistance for their own ends. The Israelis turned a blind eye to much of this over many years, and that's where we get this tunnel network and these bunkers. So as a result, whatever humanitarian aid that is getting in at, you know, the United States is pushing for this, the Israelis inspect, makes it very hard to bring in large amounts of aid. So it's a real problem. And I think the United States is handcuffed by this existential issue, by this practical issue about aid being diverted. And quite frankly, I think the president's natural inclination to align himself so closely with the Israelis then makes it hard for him to prevail upon them to do things that he would like them to do because they may not comply. And that makes the president and the United States look weak in this situation.
What was President Biden's strategy going into this?
You know, I think when you speak to Israelis throughout this conflict, they're deeply grateful for Biden's support because they feel as if they're leaderless. Israel was already experiencing very significant political turbulence, and this government was obviously caught by surprise by these attacks. I mean, it was an utter failure of political leadership and intelligence, and that Biden has provided that leadership. And I think the calculation that he made was that if he bear hugs the Israelis, he will be able to shape the way in which they approach this conflict. And I think it was a miscalculation, quite frankly, because of the way in which they define the conflict in existential terms. And if it's a fight to the death, it's very hard for an external actor, even one that is powerful as the United States, to have an influence on decision-making when people believe they're in an existential fight.
How have conversations about the conflict inflamed domestic public opinion?
I think there's two things. I think there has been an outpouring of support for Palestinians, particularly on college campuses, in other fora. I think there's been important questions asked about Israeli conduct, not just in the prosecution of the war, but also in its settlement / seemingly apparent annexation of the West Bank and the blockade of the Gaza Strip. And I think, you know, the polling has been interesting that, you know, solidly, you know, more than half of Americans remain sympathetic to Israel and that large majorities do believe that Israel has a right to respond and a right to defend itself. But the younger demographic, that changes significantly. 18 to 24-year-olds, 24 to 35-year-olds, those things change very significantly. And I think what it portends is a changing politics of Israel and the United States. Whereas, you know, you had this solid bipartisan support, which you still do in votes in Congress. But I think that masks a kind of broader range of questions that are being asked about Israeli conduct in the West Bank and the Gaza Strip, about the nature of the U.S.-Israel relationship, and that it suggests that, you know, in time, maybe 10 years from now, that it's very different. So I certainly think that there are changes that are underway, but we'll have to see.
Well, I mean, let's talk a little bit about that. How did Israel come to be such a top priority for the U.S.?
You can't isolate one period or one thing. There's politics. There's a kind of moral commitment to Israel after the horrors of World War II and the Holocaust. That's not to suggest that Israel's creation and Zionism is just a function of what happened during the Second World War. But nevertheless, there was always this kind of moral commitment. There was political aspect of it that, yeah, you know, there were electoral votes to be harvested in places where there were large concentrations of American Jews, a growing and prosperous community. And then there were these strategic issues. And that's how we get to this point where it becomes a national interest of the United States to help ensure Israeli security, that it was political, moral, historical, and a strategic imperative. Now, you may say, well, the Cold War ended 30 years ago. What's the strategic imperative now? And the idea has been since the Cold War is to normalize Israel in the region. And when you do that, you get a more peaceful region and a more prosperous region. And that accrues to, one, Israel's benefit in terms of helping to ensure Israeli security. And it helps the United States with other important goals, namely the free flow of energy resources out of the region. And what we've seen recently in this kind of effort to push the normalization of relations between Israel and its Arab neighbors, specifically Saudi Arabia, is a way in which to kind of outmaneuver the Chinese in the Middle East. Normalization between Saudi Arabia and Israel was sort of the sweetener for Congress to sign on to a Saudi-U.S. defense pact, which was specifically designed to blunt the influence of China in Saudi Arabia and in the Gulf. So it's very, very complicated. But I think the important part for listeners is to understand that when you take the combination of the politics, the moral, historical imperative post-World War II, plus geopolitics, you get the story and how we got to this place.
Is support for Israel bipartisan here in the U.S.?
It has been solidly bipartisan over decades. You know, obviously it varies. And we do have people within the Congress who are increasingly questioning Israeli conduct or even hostile to Israel. And I think, you know, polls in the spring of 2023 indicated that for the first time ever, more Democrats were sympathetic to the Palestinian cause than they were to Israel. But Israel's kind of rock solid support within the Republican Party. In fact, a senior Republican once explained to me that Israel was in that kind of, for Republicans, in that pantheon of issues up there with abortion, lower taxes, strong defense, Second Amendment, that it was as important to many Republicans as those issues as well.
Why? Why such support among Republicans?
Because among the Republican base are evangelicals. And it's interesting because if you look historically, and of course we do policy, not politics, and this is just an objective fact here, you know, American Jews who are a wellspring of support for Israel tend to vote for Democrats more than they vote for Republicans. And there is also a robust debate within the American Jewish community about Israel, whereas the evangelical community has been rock solid in its support for Israel based on kind of theological concerns. And that's something that runs throughout American history, actually.
Okay, let's zoom out. Where does the United States stand among the rest of the world? Are we unique in our support?
We are. Israelis will say, sure, you know, other countries are supportive of Israel, but there's nothing like the support from the United States. Beyond the West, Israel, when it was established in its early years, was kind of something akin to a pariah state. Obviously, Israel's establishment in 1948 is something that is celebrated by Israel supporters around the world, but in the Middle East, it's not seen as a positive moment. For the Palestinians, it was referred to as an Nakba, the catastrophe, something that is still going on, in which Palestinians were driven from their lands or left, depending on one's narrative, and many of them forced into refugee camps. In Gaza, the entire population are refugees from either 1948 and 1967, and thus began this long-term dispossession and, quite frankly, dehumanization of the Palestinian population. Of course, it's important to remember that there is also a significant Palestinian population within Israel itself. So there is this opposition to Israel's existence. It was recognized by major powers, but didn't have diplomatic relations with very many countries. It now has diplomatic relations with 166 out of 195 countries in the world. It is well integrated into the global community. And even throughout this conflict, there have been recalls of ambassadors from a number of Latin American countries. The Jordanian ambassador was recalled. The Bahraini ambassador wasn't in Israel, but he's not going back. But there hasn't been any kind of real severing of relations between Israel and other countries.
So for those who haven't been following the conflict through the years, can you give us a brief picture of the status quo in Israel and Palestine right before all of this went down?
Oh, God, where do I start with this? Broadly speaking, the Israelis, over the course of the last at least decade, were enjoying a long stretch of peace and security and economic development and economic expansion and integration in the world that they had not experienced before. And for many Israelis, the conflict with the Palestinians had become almost an afterthought. You know, Israel, phenomenally successful economically, particularly in the tech sphere. And meanwhile, while it had become a place, you know, where there was a lot of foreign direct investment and Tel Aviv was booming, and while most Israelis thought of the actual occupation of the West Bank and the blockade of the Gaza Strip, along with Egypt, Egypt was a full partner in the blockade of the Gaza Strip, these became almost afterthoughts, other than the kind of periodic violence between Israel and either Hamas or other terrorist groups in the Gaza Strip. These were kind of afterthoughts. And what was happening in the West Bank was, depending on how you count, 600,000 Israeli settlers in settlements. And settlements really don't do that justice. And these are cities. These are towns. These are, quote unquote, communities that are bigger than the town I grew up in. But the government before the war seemed to be intent on annexing territory of the West Bank. And actually being public about it. I mean, I think that the 56-year-long occupation of the West Bank, which came into Israel's possession as in the Six-Day War, when it conquered East Jerusalem and the West Bank, as well as other territory, this occupation and settlement had taken on this kind of permanence that looked like annexation of, if not the entirety of the West Bank, the parts of it where there were large numbers of Israelis. In the Gaza Strip, there was essentially this blockade. Some have described it as the world's largest open-air prison that Egypt and Israel cooperated on that limited severely Palestinian movement in and out of the Gaza Strip, what could come in and out of the Gaza Strip. There's smuggling tunnels underneath the Sinai Peninsula and the Gaza Strip where lots of material came in. And all of this because Israel and Egypt considered Hamas rule over the Gaza Strip, which began in 2007 to be a security threat. Now, the way Hamas came to rule the Gaza Strip was the following. There is something called the Palestinian Authority, which is based in Ramallah, a Palestinian city north of Jerusalem. With the strong encouragement of the Bush administration, the Palestinian Authority agreed to hold elections in 2006. Well, lo and behold, the dominant faction of the Palestinian Authority, which is a group called Fatah, did not win. Hamas won. And despite encouraging Palestinian elections, which the Israelis were opposed to, and I think the Palestinian Authority was opposed to, the United States said whoopsie and didn't recognize the outcome of those elections. And of course, the leadership of the Palestinian Authority said, we don't recognize the outcome and nor do the Israelis. This led to a confrontation in 2007 between security forces of the Palestinian Authority and Hamas won, driving the Palestinian Authority out of the Gaza Strip. It was then that Egypt and Israel got together and laid on this blockade of the Gaza Strip. That's basically where we were on October 6th. The Palestinians lived under occupation with creeping annexation in the Gaza Strip with a very aggressive Israeli government that had no intention of engaging in any kind of negotiation with the Palestinians. And in fact, some accuse it of trying to drive Palestinians out of this area. And of course, the Gaza Strip was under this restrictive blockade, but not as restrictive as perhaps people believe, because that's how Hamas built out its military infrastructure through material coming into the Gaza Strip, mostly in the form of humanitarian aid.
Let's talk about aid. U.S. aid to Israel seems to be driving a lot of the public debate right now. Israel is a pretty wealthy country. Why do we give it so much more aid, military aid, monetary aid, than our formal allies like NATO or South Korea, for example?
The United States has a national interest in helping to ensure Israeli security. I think the critics would say the United States should use that aid as a point of leverage with the Israelis for them to be more forthcoming in negotiations with the Palestinians. And people are obviously outraged by Israeli conduct in the current conflict. my argument is this, and you touched on it, is that Israel is a wealthy country. It started out as not being a wealthy country, but is a developed, industrialized country that is a leader in tech. And so the question that I raise is, do the Israelis even need it? But we don't provide that kind of copious aid to NATO allies. The problem in Israel is not that it doesn't have the means to defend itself. It's that it took its eye off the ball. It got complacent. It was snookered by Hamas. And so had the Israelis been more vigilant, had they not been so complacent, perhaps this crisis would have been avoided. But okay, here we are. It hasn't. And I think there are questions among critics of Israel about the continued aid, whereas supporters of Israel say this is a reason to continue the aid relationship with Israel.
So U.S. is involved. Do we have an official policy on how to resolve the conflict?
When Secretary Blinken was in the region, he broached the post-conflict issue by suggesting that there should be an effort to reinvigorate the Palestinian Authority. The Palestinian Authority, which is compromised by its dysfunction and massive corruption, and quite honestly, its legitimacy is compromised by its security cooperation with Israel. And a reinvigorated Palestinian Authority would then extend its authority back to the Gaza Strip, where it has been absent since 2007. And that security in the Gaza Strip would be the result of some kind of multinational effort. And that this would then set the stage for a resumption of diplomacy towards a two-state solution. I gotta be honest with you. I think this is fantasy in every which way. Neither side, for domestic political purposes, can satisfy the minimum requirements of the other side. So I didn't understand what Secretary Blinken was saying when he was talking about a two-state solution or anybody else.
Yeah, I mean, I was going to kind of wrap by asking you, what would you like people to keep in mind when assessing all of this? You know, what thoughts do you have for the rest of us?
There is a certain impossibility of this situation, that the answers that people are looking for may not exist, that this is a conflict that may not have a resolution. That's number one. Number two, and this is separate from like the Middle East. I think this is about us and our conversations about it. And it's something that I've said previously, which is we risk losing our sense of proportion and our sense of humanity in our very heated arguments about what is happening. And that keep in mind that there is suffering that is happening. Israelis are suffering. Palestinians are suffering. People are burying their dead. These are terrible, terrible things. And we're 6,000 miles away, and we're directly involved as the United States in the name of Americans. But that we shouldn't lose our sense of humanity. The discourse and dehumanization of Israelis, of Jews, of Palestinians, of Arabs in our discourse is quite frankly horrifying. And that people need to keep that in mind, that we're talking about humans. I can't emphasize that enough. It's been deeply shocking to me how we have so quickly kind of lost our sense of proportion when it comes to human suffering here.
For resources used in this episode and more information, visit cfr.org/whyitmatters and take a look at the show notes. If you ever have any questions or suggestions or just want to chat with us, email at whyitmatters@cfr.org. Or you can hit us up on Twitter at @CFR_org. Why It Matters is a production of the Council on Foreign Relations. The opinions expressed on the show are solely that of the guests, not of CFR, which takes no institutional positions on matters of policy. The show is produced by Asher Ross and me, Gabrielle Sierra. Our sound designer is Marcus Zacharia. Our associate podcast producer is Molly McEnany. Our interns this semester are Ria Basakar and Kelsey Colot. Production assistance for this episode was provided by Noah Berman. Robert McMahon is our managing editor, and Doug Halsey is our chief digital officer. Extra help for this episode was provided by Mariel Ferragamo. Our theme music is composed by Carrie Torhuson. You can subscribe to the show on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube, or wherever you get your audio. For Why It Matters, this is Gabrielle Sierra signing off. See you soon.